my heart turns from darkness to light. Anytime temptation comes and someone stands to fight. Anytime somebody lives to serve and not be served. I know, I know, I know, I know. God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move in many mighty ways. God is on the move, on the move. Choices made to stand upon the word. I know, I know, I know, I know. God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move in many mighty ways. God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move today.
Welcome to Walk in the Word for Tuesday. We are glad that you've joined us today. We're continuing through the Gospel of John. We're in chapter 13. And we're beginning today with verse 6. Yesterday, we saw the beautiful picture of Jesus washing the disciples' feet and all that that meant and all that that involved. Today, we're going to look at some of the reaction specifically from Simon Peter on what he thought and his reaction to Jesus washing the feet of the disciples. And so if you have your Bibles, turn with me to John chapter 13, beginning with verse 6. And let's begin with a word of prayer. Father, I thank you for today's message. I thank you for this Bible study that we can have every day to gather together to spend time with you. Father, we thank you today for your message to us through your word. And Father, I pray that we would receive a blessing from it, but that we would not just harbor that blessing, but that we would then be a blessing to others as a result of what we've heard and seen and now what we will have done because of the message from today's lesson. So Father, bless us. Allow the Holy Spirit to be our teacher and guide as we work together. We give you thanks and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. John chapter 13, beginning with verse 6. Now remember, yesterday Jesus had gotten up from from the feast of the Passover. It was Thursday evening. And before they had the meal, Jesus did something that shocked the disciples. He got up and he began to wash the feet of his disciples. We talked a little bit about the significance of that yesterday. Today I want to get the reaction of some of the disciples, specifically Peter. Let's begin with verse 6. It says, he came to Simon Peter, who said to him, Lord, do you wash my feet? Now, we have to understand, Jesus washing their feet embarrassed all of the disciples. Remember yesterday we talked about the fact that washing feet was relegated to the lowest of people in a society. And so for this leader, for this Messiah, to bow down and wash the feet of the disciples was disheartening at least and disconcerting at best. And so Peter is being honest. Lord, do you wash my feet? In other words, he's saying to Jesus, Lord, what are you doing? Why are you washing my feet? It should be the other way around. But Jesus answered him, verse 7, what am I doing? What I am doing, you do not understand now, but afterward you will understand. Jesus is saying, look, I am giving you a lesson that will carry you through beyond my death, burial, and resurrection. What I'm about to show you, what I'm about to do for you, I want you then, well, we'll see that. He says, I want you to do that to others. Verse 8, Peter said to him, you shall never wash my feet. Remember, I love Peter because Peter always kind of literally or figuratively sticks his foot in his mouth all the time. He says, you will never wash my feet. In other words, I'm not going to allow you to stoop so low as to wash my feet. But look at what Jesus said. In verse 8, the middle of verse 8, Jesus answered him, if I do not wash you, you have no share with me. In other words, Jesus is saying to him, if you don't allow me to do this, then you're not going to have anything to do with what happens after this. Jesus is basically drawing a line in the sand and saying, look, you either do it my way or it's the highway. I mean, that's what he's saying. He's saying, if I do not wash you, you have no share in me. You have no share with me. Simon Peter said then, obviously he got the message, and he said, Lord, not my feet also, but also my hands and my head. Now, you need to understand that what Jesus is doing is really on two levels. This washing the feet is a demonstration. Remember, Jesus came to be an example for you and for me on how we should live our lives. He was an example to the disciples on how they should live their lives, and by extension, to you and me on how we should live our lives. But we've got to learn that we've got to do it Jesus' way. We can't decide that we're going to hear what Jesus said and then do it our way. We've got to follow Jesus' example. And what Jesus is demonstrating here is something that we as staunch individualists in the United States of America need to learn, and that is that if we're going to be a leader in the kingdom of God, we've got to be a servant leader. We've got to be willing to stoop to the lowest job necessary, to the most unpleasant task, if that's what it takes to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. We've got to be willing to do that. Jesus took on the form of a servant, almost the form of a slave here when he washed their feet. Well, Peter got the message, and he said, Lord, not only my feet, but my hands and my head, and basically saying, wash my whole body. Look at verse 10. Jesus said to him, the one who has bathed does not need to wash except for his feet, but is completely clean. Now, here's the other aspect of what Jesus is doing here. The first one is this idea of servant leadership. The second is that he is referring to the cleansing, pay attention, the cleansing that takes place as a result of his death on the cross. Remember, his death on the cross paid the penalty for your sin and for my sin. And so, we who accept Jesus Christ as our Savior, those of us who believe that Jesus is indeed the Savior of the world, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him would not perish but have eternal life. That Jesus came to provide salvation to the world. But it's not a universal salvation. It's a salvation to those who believe, to those who embrace this idea that what Jesus did on the cross was to pay the penalty for the sin that you and I deserve. And so what Jesus is saying here to Simon Peter is, he says, the one who has bathed does not need to wash except for his feet, but is completely clean. In other words, what he's saying is, if you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, that is a one-time event. You don't have to go back and do that again and again. Jesus doesn't have to get back up on the cross and die again so that you can once again be saved again. It is a one-time event. A one-time event. And once you've accepted that, guess what? Your sins are forgiven. You are completely clean. You are completely clean. In other words, all of the sin that you have committed, past, present, and future sin, is covered by the blood of Jesus Christ on the cross. That is a powerful statement, and that's what Jesus is saying here. The one who has bathed, the one who has received the cleansing power of the blood of Christ through salvation, does not need to wash, but is completely clean. Now, it says, except for his feet. What's the exception there? Well, see, there's something that we have to do. The Bible is very clear. It says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive our sins and cleanse us. There's that word cleansing again. It's completely clean. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we confess our sin. So, if I sin today, what do I need to do? I need to confess my sin. Does that mean it's not forgiven? Certainly it's forgiven. It's forgiven, but it's important for us to acknowledge it. Why is that important? It's important for us to acknowledge it because otherwise we would use what Jesus did on the cross as a reason to continue to sin. The Apostle Paul warned us against that. He said, should we continue to sin that grace may abound? It's a rhetorical question, but then he answers it and he says, God forbid. In other words, we can't use what Jesus did on the cross as a license to go out and do whatever we want because, after all, my sins are forgiven, so I can go do whatever I want. In fact, what he says next indicates a heart like that because that's exactly the kind of heart that Judas had. He says, the one who has bathed does not need to wash except for his feet, but is completely clean. And then he looks at the disciples and he says, and you are clean. Then look what he says next. But not every one of you. Not every one of you. In other words, just because Jesus died on the cross doesn't mean that everybody's sins are covered. You have to have a changed heart. And that comes by acknowledging that Jesus is God's Son, that he died on the cross for your sins and for my sins, and you accept that payment, that penalty for sin that Jesus paid on the cross as payment for your guilt, your sin guilt. And when you do that, your sins are forgiven. Why are we forgiven? Why does God do that for us? So that we can then go out and wash other people's feet. Not so that we can go out and have an ulterior motive like Judas did. You are clean, he says, but not every one of you. Verse 11, for he knew who was to betray him. That was why he said, not all of you are clean. See, he could look into the hearts of men, and he knew these 12 guys that were sitting around the table with him. And he knew that 11 of them were going to follow through. He knew that 11 of them were going to get the message, and one of them was going to betray him. Here's the question. It's an important question. You need to answer it. Are you the one who's going to follow him? Or are you the one who's going to betray him? We're going to conclude today's lesson with that thought. Let's close with a word of prayer. Father, I thank you. I thank you for the message of today. And I ask, Father, that as we continue through this lesson, Father, that we can see the importance of being a disciple, a follower of Jesus Christ, one who follows after him, doing his work and his will the way that he would have us to do it. Father, we thank you for the blessings of this day and for the blessings that we have as you give us opportunity to serve you. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Well, we would love for you to be a part of our ministry. How can you do that? You can contribute financially. This is not a ministry of David Corum, but this is a ministry of Living Waters Community Church in Oak Grove. And we would love for you to have a part in the ministry, the continuing support of our ministries throughout our community and throughout the world. How can you do that? There, right on the screen, is a way you can do that. You can contribute to the ministry of Living Waters Community Church by using the Tithely app. It's a simple app. You can get it in the iTunes App Store or the Google Play Store. Just look for tithe.ly. You can download that and then look for Living Waters Community Church as your church. Go ahead and lock that in. And there's one thing else that I would encourage you to do. Down near the bottom, once you're ready to make your contribution, there's a little slider. If you slide that to the right, it allows you to pay the fee that we have to pay every time someone gives through the Tithely app. It's not a lot of money, but a little bit adds up. And I mentioned to our church on Sunday that since we began using the Tithely app, that those who have contributed have saved our church over $4,000. That's a powerful amount of money. You can do the same by adding that little bit of a fee to your contribution and thereby giving us a clean amount that we can use to do ministry. So use that. There's also a direct link there on the screen that you can use. We hope that you're receiving a blessing from this. And if you are, share it with others. Let people know about A Walk in the Word. We're here every morning, Monday through Friday at 9 a.m. Join us tomorrow for A Walk in the Word. Take care and God bless.